أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لإسلام دينا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد صلوات
الله وسلم وعلى
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما باقية الله في الأرضين إمام صاحب العصر والزمان روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمهم الفداء يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكمه تنزيل وقوله الحق وهو أصدق القائلون بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيراً والذاكرات أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد Respected elders, brothers, sisters, youngsters, children, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All thanks belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has bestowed upon us this opportunity and chance again to be gathered here on this auspicious day of Jummah, on this Friday, in the Jama'ah, in the Masjid, in the company of believing men and women and children, inshallah, to perform Salatul Jummah in Jama'ah. We thank Allah for this opportunity and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the guidance of Islam He has guided us to, inshallah. And we send peace and salutations upon the last messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, to his family and to the truthful companions of his, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who have followed this great messenger of Islam in the true sense of following him, inshallah. Today's discussion of this day of Jummah, I would like to discuss the verse 35 of Surah chapter 33 of the Quran, Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 33, inshallah. As you remember, as you know, yesterday we were celebrating Women's Day. In South Africa, it was a public holiday. Students, children, you didn't go to school yesterday because it was a Women's Day. There was celebration of society recognizing and honoring the women for their role and their contribution they play in our society. Islam also has given the women a higher status. My discussion today is the role of the women and the girls and sisters in the establishment in religion, in Islam, in the establishment of the system of Dawlatun Karima. We always pray for Dawlatun Karima. Tu'izzu biha al-Islam wa ahla. Wa tudillu biha al-nifaq wa ahla. We all pray every day in the dua of Imam al-Zaman of the establishment of an Islamic system. An Islamic system that will honor Islam, that will honor Allah, that will honor God, and the worship of God, that will be divinely guided. And an establishment that will shame the hypocrites and the oppression and the oppressors. But how will this come to existence? The role of our sisters, the role of our mothers is highlighted in the establishment of such system. Inshallah, today we look at how Quran and Islam has given such high status to the women. When the Westerners, they were still questioning about the insaniya, the status, the essence of a woman, whether he's a full, complete insan, or whether have... We know in history there has been discourses, philosophical discourses in Christianity, about whether a woman has a soul or not. And these discourses are, they are still continuing in Christianity, in some Western philosophers and thinkers. The same way they questioned whether a black man has a soul or not, and it built ground, it paved the ground for them to kidnap, to enslave the black man, because they were under impression that a black man does not have a soul. The same way they questioned women in Sani, the status of a woman. Is she a complete human being or is she a half human being? When the Arabs, when Islam came in the 6th century, in 7th century, a woman was so much oppressed. A woman was so highly oppressed. A daughter, a girl was so much oppressed that if a man gave birth to a child, she would look side, worrying, while they are checking about the gender. And if it happens to be a girl, he will cry and he will go and bury the daughter alive. This was the status of a woman prior to the rise of the Messenger of Allah, the final emissary of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Please be salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Therefore, the first challenge Islam faced was to teach to the Arab community that a woman, a girl, a baby girl is same as a baby boy. So many verses of the Quran have been revealed to protect women. وَإِذَا الْمَوْلُودَةِ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. On the day of judgment, when a baby girl will ask and say, for which sin have been committed? For which sin have I been killed? So Islam came in a situation where the Arabs took a woman as a tool of entertainment. And they took entertainment from women. And after entertaining with women, they'll discharge them however they want, in whichever manner they wanted. A woman was not a complete human being. We see even in Christianity discourses where Christians, philosophers and thinkers, theological discussion, questioning whether a woman has a soul or not. It is only in the 1930 in Canada where women were officially given a right to vote. It is only in the 19th century when American women were given right to vote and sit as men. In Britain was the same thing. So Islam gave the rights to women 600 years. While in the United States and Canada, in 1930s, women were not allowed to vote. Therefore today, we join the whole world to celebrate the mighty power and status of women. But we say Islam, contrary to what is being portrayed today, Islam is the only system that gave rights to women earlier than any other system. So Quran, when it speaks about the status of a woman, a girl and a boy, there is no differences. That's why I started the verse of the Quran, verse number 35 of Surah Al-Ahzab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in akhlaq and in qualities of a human being, what makes a human being a human being? It's also a debate of what is insan. According to definition, insan is hayawanu natiq, is a rational animal. So we are all animals with the dogs and cows and dogs. We all fall under the category of animals. But what makes us different from animals is that rationality, that philosophical capacity to think, to question, to understand, to judge. This capacity of thinking is what makes us human. So, when it comes to this capacity, we all are equal. We all have this capacity. Girls and boys are all rational beings. There is no difference. According to Quran, they can all achieve the higher status of iman and the higher status of belief. Quran says, "Innal muslimin wal muslimat." Indeed, the submissive men and the submissive women. The Muslims, men and Muslim men, women. Allah is emphasizing this issue that the question of Islam and submission to the will of Allah, there is no gender predisposition. All sexes, all genders have the capacity to acquire this quality of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, Quran here is equaling men to women in terms of iman, Islam. وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ Allah discusses, and the believing men and the believing women. وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ And those God-fearing, submissive, the humble men and the humble women inside of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here Allah is giving us the equality. He's showing us that in the matter of iman, Islam, taslim, men and women, we are equal. We all have that capacity to climb to the spiritual highest, high levels, to go closer to Allah. We are equal as men and women. وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ The truthful men and the truthful women. We all have the capacity to speak the truth. We all have the possibility, if we train ourselves as men and as women, we all can speak the truth. وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ Therefore, there's no gender predisposition in speaking lies. Sometimes we say women are liars, but it's not women who are liars, not men. Everyone can have capacity to be a liar. If you exercise lying, you'll become a liar. If you exercise speaking the truth, you become truthful, whether you are a man or a woman, a girl or a boy. So Allah is showing us that in the matter of iman and Islam and these attributes of iman, we are all equal, men and women. Therefore, when we celebrate the day of women in Islam, Islam has given these values 600 years ago. When Westerners did not have these values, Islam has given the rights to the women in these years. وَالْخَاشِئِينَ وَالْخَاشِئَاتِ Allah speaks of the God-fearing men and the God-fearing women. وَالْمُتَصَدِّقِينَ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقَاتِ The charitable men and charitable women. The men who are freely giving to charity and the women who are freely. So the issue of stinginess is not a gender issue. Allah shows us in the issue of giving in the path of Allah to the needy, the destitute, it is a quality that man has and the woman has. متصدقين والمتصدقات. We can all give sadaqah. Men can, women can. So this verse actually is emphasizing. Most of the time when the Quran speaks generally and speaks for men, uses the dhamir of a man, but he is meaning for everyone. But in this verse, Allah is emphasizing the issue of equality in genders. Those women also have the capacity to strive to achieve these qualities. وَالصَّائِمِينَ وَالصَّائِمَاتِ Those who fast, fasting men, fasting women. وَالْحَافِظِينَ فُرُوجَهُمْ وَالْحَافِظَاتِ Those who are disciplined when it comes to the sexual relationship. And women who, men who are disciplined, women who are disciplined. So this issue is not a gender issue. وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ There is men who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot. Men who are constantly in remembrance of Allah in their daily activities. And there are women who are in that condition, in that status. There are women who have achieved that status. Whether they are doing their daily activities, they are constantly remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا For all of this we mentioned, men and women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised and has prepared for them maghfirah, forgiveness. Allah will forgive these individuals, men and women, wa ajran azima, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared a huge reward on the day of Qiyamah, in Barzakha, on the day of Qiyamah, for these men and women who are disciplined, who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are humble, who are merciful to other insans. So, this verse of this Surah Al-Ahzab discusses the issue of gender equality in terms of quality. In terms of fadail or fazila, in terms of fazilat, fadail, there is no difference between men and women. We all have the same fadail, we all have the same quality when we work for them. If you strive very hard to become truthful, as a child you become truthful. Whether you are a boy or a girl, mother is the same thing, father is the same thing. So therefore, the issue of fadail, we are all equal. However, there is something called fara'id. Fara'id, when it comes to responsibilities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the creator of man, has given different responsibilities to people. And this does not interpret superiority in any house. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, has given a man certain responsibilities. You play certain responsibilities because of your position in society, the one for which Allah has appointed you for certain jobs. However, it does not mean that we are not equal, or we are more fortunate, or we are more, for example, a man has a job of responsibility. When it comes to financial status of the home, the father is in duty, the father is in charge. It is the father's duty to feed the children, to buy food, to buy clothes, to feed the wife. Allah has given him that duty. It does not mean Allah, the husband becomes superior to the wife. It's just different duties. And for that duty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, gives the father a permission to marry two wives, three wives, four wives. A permission that Allah does not give to a woman. Therefore, today's women, when you think of your equality with Allah, with the husband, with the males, it does not mean you have the same fara'id. You occupy the same responsibility in the society. You are equal. You have capacity to be high, to climb to the highest degree in the society. But remember that Allah has given you certain fara'id. Allah has appointed a job for you. Therefore, Allah's creation of a woman, Allah creating a woman, He had a plan for the woman, and He appointed a certain responsibility for the woman. So, by carrying these responsibilities, does not mean that you are inferior. It simply means you are submissive to Allah, to that which Allah has created you for. For example, you may be a very famous individual in the community, and you are driving an expensive car. I don't know the cars today you are going to make money from, but I'm giving example of an expensive car. You're driving expensive car, you go to the robot. Whether you have blue light on it, you are an important person. When you arrive by the robot is red. The robot is red. You are a mayor, for example. The robot is red. You are going to stop by the robot. But look at the ambulance man. The ambulance comes with his overalls. He comes by the red robot, you are standing, he passes you, he just passed. Because his responsibility in the society, the law has given him permission to cross the red robot because he is in an emergency situation. There is a job he's doing. And that job, he cannot afford to stand on the robot. That's why when he arrives by the robot, everyone has to stop. Even if the traffic light does not allow him to pass, he passes. The example I want to give here is that this man does not mean that he's more superior to the mayor who is stopping by the robot. But he's occupying a specific job. He's doing a job that allows him to pass. In fara'id, Allah has given duties to women and duties to men. But your duty does not mean you are inferior. If your job is today to give birth to the children and give tarbiyah to the children, does not mean giving birth to the children and giving tarbiyah to the children. It doesn't make you inferior. This is what Allah has created you for. So when we celebrate the Day of Women, we need to reposition our women in our society and give them the rightful position that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to them. The creation of a woman was the greatest sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِيهِ. When Allah in Surah Rum discusses the issue of the signs, the greatest signs of Allah that Allah is proud of to show, this is what I have done. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. It is that among his signs is that he has created from you women for you, wives for you. Mufassirin, when they interpret this verse, they bring an issue of azwajan, min anfusikum azwajan. Allah did not mean anfusikum imraatun, for example. He used this word azwajan to say Allah has created these beautiful ladies and women for them to be married to men so that they can create a home. The issue of tazwij comes in. The issue of marriage institution comes in. That was a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to create every creation into couples. Subhanalladhi khalaqa al-azwaja kullaha mimma tunbitul ard wa min anfusihim wa mimma la ya'lamun. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has created couples, wives, couples, min anfusihim, mimma tunbitul ard, even min alamun nabat, even from the creation, from the plants, Allah created males and females. Boys and girls in trees. Did you know that among the trees there are boys and girls? Children, do you know that? That among the trees there are girl trees and boy trees? Allah created trees, boys and girls. Allah created men, women. Allah created amongst everything, mimma tunbitul ard wa min anfusihim. Even amongst us, Allah created couples. Wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathira. So this is the example of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has given a high responsibility and a status to the woman prior to this Western claiming rights to women. So we are saying that Allah created a woman for a specific purpose. And He has done these couples in every creation that Allah has created. When Allah, this verse was revealed amongst the Arabs, they didn't know. The only thing they knew that there is males and female was human beings. And their goats and camels, they knew. But sometimes they didn't know that amongst even whatever we see, there is couples. Today it's not a miracle. Today we know that there is even among those which we did not know, among that which Arabs did not know by the time of revelation of the verse, today we know there are positive charges, there are negative charges, there are males and females in everything, amongst the bacteria, among everything. So this verse is showing us the beauty of creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has the plan to create a woman and to make her the foundation of the society. In Islam, a woman is the foundation of society. A woman is the first manufacturing plant of human being society. Our society is a product of human beings produced in homes. Just think of manufacturing of plants, manufacturing of the bricks, the tina. We have five manufacturing bricks, five manufacturing companies in Kwande Valley that produce bricks. One home, one plant is mixing, you know, I'm giving an example, is mixing the cement and robbing the cement. It's putting one cement in ten cents. 10 to 1. One company is producing quality bricks that is made in half, maybe 5 to 5. And these bricks, we are bringing them all together to build a home. To build a society. A masjid, a house, is an example of a society. A society is made by individuals that come from different homes. Therefore, If we mean to build a society like a South African society is made of children that were produced in different homes, if one mother did not play his key role, what will happen? It is that child who will come from the society and rape other children, and stab other children, and steal and kill. The society we want to build is made primarily from the homes. And therefore that is why the role of a woman, that's why Allah praised the woman, because she was the foundation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in so many verses of the Quran, when Allah speaks about worshipping of Allah, second to none is the mother. Second to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the woman, is the mother who gives. When Allah speaks about وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ, Be careful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you are dependent on Allah. Everything you need, you have to ask from Allah. You are dependent to Allah. Be careful of His duties. الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ, because everything you depend on Him. وَالْأَرْحَامِ, and be careful of the wombs that bear you. Be careful of the wombs that gave birth to you. In many verses of the Quran, when Allah speaks about him, the second from Allah is the mothers. That shows how Islam has given the rights to women. Islam has honored women before this Western society is coming to tell us that now we have to honor women, now it's a women's day. Then suddenly you have to go and write on Facebook, Islam has taught us the rights of women. The importance of homes and relationship and the marriages. Islam has encouraged marriages because it's new from these marriages, that's where our society members are formed. There's so many ahadiths and riwayat that encourages youth to marry, to get married. Man istata'a ilaykum al-ba'a falyatazawwaj, ya ma'ashara al-shabab, all the youth, anyone who is capable of getting married, falyatazawwaj, tazawwaju, takthuru. Get married so that you can become more. This is so many riwayat in the Quran and the Sunnah that shows that Allah had created a woman for a specific purpose of creation of generation to come, human reproduction also, in the tarbiyah and education of our society. We depend on our mothers, we depend on women. They are the first teachers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He speaks about the first education you receive, He refers to the mothers. وَالَّذِي أَخْرَجَ مِنْ بُيُوتِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْرِفُونَ شَيْئًا. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who extracted you from the wombs of your mothers. At the moment you did not know nothing. The first education you receive is from your mother. You did not know nothing. Even the first education you receive, how to suckle, how to feed yourself, is from your mother. That's how Quran has made so many references to the women and to the mothers, to show that they are not just equal to us. They are even more equal than us. Women, there is ishkalat that Allah did not send any prophet who is a woman. But if you are a Shia and read Hadith al-Kisa, you will see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave references to Fatima even before his own father, Sayyidul Anbiya wal Mursaleen, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. In Hadith al-Kisa, we read when everyone is asking, Jibra'il, who is Oman Tahd al-Kisa? Who is covered? Who is under the Kisa? And the response, what is the response from Jibra'il? Ya Fatima, it is Fatima in the Kisa, and his husband and his father and her husband and her children. Why is that? The most important in Kisa, the most important individual and figure in Hadith al-Kisa is who? Fatima to Zahra. Please read salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali.
Why is that Jibra'il not responding? It is the prophet and his daughter. No? Because the most important figure under Hadith al-Kisa is Fatima. Even though she did not have the Nubuwa or the Imama, but she is the most respected. The Prophet used to call her Ummu Abiha. He said that he did not respect her as a daughter only, but also as her own mother, as his own mother. Prophet said, I was an orphan at a young age. I did not have an opportunity to respect my mother. Fatima is my mother. All the respect I was supposed to give to Amina, I will give it to Fatima, to Zahra. So this shows how important Islam has given to the daughters and the girls. Therefore, the Western society that was oppressing women until the 19th century, until 20th century, in America they were still debating whether a woman has a soul or not, cannot today and come and teach us that a woman has now to be promoted and Islam suddenly is the oppressor of the woman. If you read the Quran, the system of the West today, when they are trying to promote women, is for one purpose. It is the system of Fir'aun. If you remember in the verse of the Quran when Allah refers to Fir'aun, in Surah Anbiya, you will find such verses. In Surah Al-Qasas, you will find those verses. When Allah says, Inna Fir'aun ala fil ard. Fir'aun was so arrogant in the way. He made himself Allah. He was so arrogant, extremely arrogant. Ala fil ard. He was Aliyun. There's no one be above him. Just start the Ifutaif. Fir'aun has certain political maneuvers. One of them to stay in power forever and to impose it on himself on his people was that Yastadi Ifutaifa. Yuzabbihu abna'ahum wa yastahiyu nisa'ahum. He was dividing the people. He was divide and rule. That was one of the policies of the Western. When they were committing slavery, it was divide and rule. They are still applying it today. Yastadi Ifutaifa. Yuzabbihu abna'ahum. They make a certain group of people weak. But what they were doing among Banu Israel in Egypt was even worse. يَسْتَحْيُ نِسَاءَهُمْ. They used to promote women. Istihya in all means. Istihya economically. They used to let the women live, survive economically. They will give the women favors, the jobs, the opportunities. وَيُذَبِّهُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. They used to kill their men. And today when they say the most dictatorial governments, you find women in parliament, 90% women in parliament, 80%, they are promoting istihya nisa. They are trying to promote women to position of, but for what purpose? Is it for the purpose of empowering women? No, it is for enjoyment of these women. Today it is a well known that if you want to get a job, if you are beautiful, it's so easy. The same way the Arabs were using women as tools of sexual enjoyment, entertainment. It is not for the purpose of empowering our daughters that they are promoting them. It is for them to have a company of women to enjoy whenever they want in their offices, in their governments. They don't care about these women. So therefore, Islam gave the right position of a woman, and West was giving women the position of being entertained, entertainment and being enjoyed. Today we see the government that doesn't care about men. Suddenly today, we're caring about women. So, istihya un-nisa we see today, it is the same istihya un-nisa of Fir'aun. They want to organize the rallies where the women will come and demonstrate their beauties, do the marathon naked, and the men will be enjoying. They want to be this entertainment place where women will go half naked and men are going to see them. And this is what they call freedom to women. No, this is not freedom to women. Islam came to rescue women from this behavior, from this mafhum, from this mantik that a woman is an object of entertainment. Islam says a mother is an educator of the society, is the most important brick in the society. It is one of the signs of creation of Allah. Min ayati an khalaqa lakum min anfusikum azwajan. A woman is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She is gold. She doesn't have to be demonstrated naked. She is gold. She has to be kept in that way, inshallah. So Islam gave recognition to the women and to the rights of women. And today we don't have to learn from Westerners how to treat our women, inshallah. Today that's the message, inshallah, for the day of Jummah today. We have to know that to our women, our mothers, you are our gold. You are our educators. You have to know your right position in society. It is that to educate our future. It is that to create the future of our country and of our world. Inshallah, lies in your hands. The kind of education you give to us, to our children, is the kind of men and women who will occupy the offices of tomorrow. It is the kind of leaders we will have tomorrow. It is the product of your work. Therefore, you have to take yourself so very seriously. You don't need men to go and demonstrate you and parade you naked to show you that you are empowered. You are empowered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are empowered by your position, inshallah, that Allah has given to you. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wal asr innal insana lafi khusr. إلى الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات